lecture by Judge Robert Sparno, who's very kindly come from Strasbourg to speak to us tonight. As you know, Judge Sparno is the judge of the European Court of Human Rights elected in respect of Iceland. He was elected in November 2013. And in May this year, he was elected to be the president of Section 2 of the Strasbourg Court. You may know that the court is divided into five administrative sections, so at any one time there are five judges or a president of section, Robert's president of section two. And he previously served originally as the parliamentary ombudsman in Iceland and also as a professor and dean of the Faculty of Law at the University of Iceland. I wanted to extend my thanks to Judge Sparno, not just for his being here this evening, but actually for a whole series of ways in which he's contributed to Middlesex. He very kindly met a group of students. We do an annual study trip to Strasbourg where they have been like students from first year right through to PhD, have been lucky enough to meet judges of the court, including Judge Sparno. About this time last year, he also kindly spoke at the launch of a book that Philip Leach and I wrote on parliaments and the European Court of Human Rights. And I was embarrassed to say that he's going to be speaking at another Middlesex event next month in Strasbourg on the court's approach to the court's developing approach to remedies. So this adds up to, in my view, a very substantial contribution by Judge Sparno, certainly to our work. And I think it's an indication of how far he personally, but I must say also the court as an institution, is open to engagement with academia, with academics and students as well. And I think it's an openness and a generosity which has certainly enriched our academic work, both in respect to teaching and research. And I think in the challenging context of the UK, where you know human rights discourse has taken such a disastrous turn in many ways in recent years, that our ability to engage directly with practitioners of the court, judges and also officials of the court and the Strasbourg system more generally, has been immensely valuable, because it does ensure that our work is sort of connected to the real life practice of the court, the challenges it faces, and hopefully enables us to contribute in some small way to addressing those challenges. Which brings me to the title of Judge Sparno's lecture this evening, The Future of the Court Towards Process-Based Review, which I think is a timely and pressing topic, not least here in the UK, where one of the dominant critiques of the Strasbourg system, if you like, has been the sort of what is often called the democratic critique, or the suggestion that supranational human rights supervision is somehow undemocratic or even anti-democratic. Now, I think in the UK, the motivations for that critique are very often disingenuous, and its articulation is often very informed. But nevertheless, I think it's important that the institutions in Strasbourg, perhaps particularly the court, respond to it, and indeed are responding to it in terms of reconceiving their relationship with democratically elected authorities at the national level. And I think one of the benefits of this is that it's driven by a need to encourage kind of ownership of human rights among elected authorities, where of course often we have this resisting of the idea of human rights obligations by elected politicians. So what will this process of reconceptualization mean for well-established principles, the margin of appreciation, subsidiarity, proportionality, and so on? A fascinating topic, and I think there are a few people better placed than Robert to address those issues. So without any further ado, I will hand over to Judge Robert Sparno.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure for me to be here at Middlesex. When I departed Strasbourg and I was telling my colleagues that I was going to the UK to talk about the court and its work, a good friend of mine, group of judges, he said, I hope I see you on Monday. Kidding aside, I think I fully share the view just presented by Professor Donald. I think it is extremely important that the debate on the court, the debate on the convention system continues. The problem with the debate sometimes is that the parameters of the debate, the facts, the issues we are talking about are perhaps not fully informed. I have been, along with many of my colleagues, engaged in talking about the court openly, transparently, honestly, to be a part of, to the extent that a sitting judge can be a part of this debate at all, to at least give a sense of how we are developing our case law, how we perceive the status of the convention system at any point in time. I give this talk clearly at a transformative moment for the convention system, not just in this country, but across Europe. So what I want to do in this lecture, this speech, is to, for about 45 minutes, I want to look back in time, I want to describe the present, and also reflect on the future. Before starting, I want to be clear that I embark on this precarious venture, as always, with some words of good wisdom as expressed by my old colleague and former UK judge, Paul Mahoney, when he recently said, "The most important attitude of mind that a judge should attempt to cultivate is a deep respect for his or her ignorance." So it's on that basis and with that sober reminder that my starting point is the following. I'm going to assert that the historical trajectory of the European Court of Human Rights since its inception in 1959 can be characterized by the court starting from scratch by rendering judgment at the outset into a human rights void, where national authorities, in particular national judges, were not familiar with the legal language of human rights. National systems in the member states either did not recognize convention rights as enforceable norms, or if they did, national actors and stakeholders were both unaware of their true potential and at the same time their natural limits in democratic societies. On this basis, I will make two interrelated claims this evening. Firstly, that as a consequence of this historical trajectory, the Strasbourg Court has, for the better part of its history to date, been engaged in embedding. And I will use this term carefully here, embedding convention principles into the national systems. The last 40 years or so thus constituted the court's embedding phase. Secondly, and more importantly, this embedding phase has now in general come to an end. The court is currently shifting its focus from its decades-long embedding work towards the domestic enforcement of already settled principles and the domestic empowerment of convention stakeholders at national level. The current historical phase of the Strasbourg Court can thus be termed the procedural enforcement phase. I will argue that this two-dimensional trajectory is both descriptively correct and normatively justified. In other words, that first, as a matter of empirical fact, my rendition of convention's history actually happened, and secondly, and more importantly, that this trajectory is a good one from a normative point of principle for the future of the convention system, its sustained legitimacy, and continued effectiveness. So our journey begins at the origins of the convention system. The history of the convention has been recounted in some remarkable pieces of scholarship. Among them, foremost among them, is Professor Ed Bates's book, The Evolution of the European Convention on Human Rights. There are others. There's a new book by a very good scholar, Marco Duranti, which I will recommend to you as well if you want a more politically scientific oriented view. Ed Bates points out that the first few years of the court were performed in relative obscurity, the sleeping beauty awaiting to awaken to realize its full potential. The awakening then occurred in the 1970s with a shift in mental attitudes, as recorded by Professor Bates in a recent article. The court entered then what I termed here before the embedding phase. And here I'm drawing on language presented in a seminal article from 2008 by Professor Lawrence Helfer, which, to those of you that haven't read it, I highly recommend. He was using the term embeddedness in a bit different sense than I use it here, but it's very useful for me for present purposes. Starting towards the middle of the 1970s, the court thus began strategically embedding the convention into the national legal systems of the member states by developing its case law both broadly and deeply, pursuing this trajectory crucially within political environments of member states which were receptive towards the idea of an integrationist and an internationalist framework of human rights protection. Now, before proceeding further, allow me to make the following caveat. My claim here is not that this trajectory has necessarily been a conscious one. In other words, a fully organized methodological judicial project decided, so to speak, by the judges on a particular day at a particular time. My claim is different. How it happened is what I'm talking about. Why it happened is for others to give their scientific reasons for. That's why we have academics. Let me move on to describing the historical stages of the embedding phase. They comprise four elements. Firstly, in the 1970s and 80s, the old court and the commission started formulating most of the convention's overarching structural, interpretational, institutional principles, namely the living instrument doctrine, the principle of autonomy of convention rights, the principle of effectiveness, the principle of subsidiarity, and its functional tool, the margin of appreciation. Secondly, during the last 40 years or so, the court has been called on to formulate the general principles for the interpretation of almost all convention rights. A great many commentaries on the convention, guides, and handbooks are now available for judges and practitioners, as well as the convention having been analyzed in meticulous detail by scholars from all possible angles. In other words, it is a relatively rare case that comes before us in which we find ourselves confronted with truly novel questions of convention law. I would, in fact, allow myself to make the claim that it is in approximately 95% of cases we deal with day to day, the case law is close to well established. At least the general principles applicable to the issue at hand, although a case-specific factual assessment can, of course, remain a matter of debate among the judges. Thirdly, my third component. Due to the massive influx of cases, in particular after the expansion of the Council of Europe to the east after the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, the pending case law now roughly including 90,000 cases, the courts reform processes have, I submit, as their overarching theme, the increased embeddedness of the convention at national level. As the convention lacks direct embeddedness, this is one of the terms used by Professor Helfer, in other words, it does not occupy a formal place in the judicial hierarchies of the member states, they were strongly encouraged to incorporate the convention directly into their national laws, a project which was completed by the early years of the new millennium. Fourthly, my fourth component, and probably the most important one. At the jurisprudential level, in the last decade or so, or to be precise, during the last period of the embedding phase, an important shift in the court's case law started to manifest itself. The court began reformulating its case law to increase further the embeddedness of convention principles by firstly tightening the screws around the requirement of the exhaustion of domestic remedies. Related to this development was the increased emphasis by the Strasbourg court on the need for effective domestic remedies as required by Article 13 of the Convention. Secondly, important case law, in particular grand chamber judgments, have increasingly been formulated in terms of providing in the general principles part objective interpretational criteria that can guide national decision makers in their application of the Convention at ground level. I will return to these jurisprudential elements in a moment. So to sum up this first part, the convention enterprise began as a novel and perhaps to some extent politically underestimated system of international enforcement of human rights. Member states who took part in the project at the outset took it almost for granted that they would not have any problems with upholding their convention obligations, simply because the political ideal of international human rights as enforceable legal norms, limiting policy choices and room for domestic decision making, was in itself underdeveloped or even considered in some quarters as unthinkable. to give life to the convention's fundamental values, the court thus needed to build an elaborate edifice of human rights, both at the substantive as well as the methodological level. But always bearing in mind that under Article 1 of the Convention, it is the member states who are the primary providers and guarantors of convention rights. The attempt at embedding the convention into the national legal systems was thus, in my view, an inevitable historical trajectory for the court if the convention was to fulfill its potential. It could, of course, have gone very differently, in particular if the political landscape in the 1970s, 80s, and 90s had been instinctively averse to international intrusions akin to the situation we see today. And it is to this part that I now turn, where I will reflect on the current landscape, the problems facing the convention system at present, and the way the court is dealing with them now and should in the future. Let's begin by characterizing the problems that some argue the convention system currently faces. They can be formulated in different ways, but allow me to proceed for the sake of argument on the assumption that the Strasbourg Court and the convention system is, at least to some extent, confronted with a legitimacy problem. Now, to be clear, what do I mean by a legitimacy problem? The answer to that question is crucial, because a faulty conceptual analysis of the convention's perceived legitimacy problem will, by definition, produce faulty answers to how such a problem, if it exists, should be addressed. The answer I offer has two components, but before I explain them in turn, let me be clear. I will, in what follows, only attempt to characterize the nature and scope of the problem as it has been argued by critics and commentators of the convention system. I don't necessarily subscribe from a personal standpoint to them, although I acknowledge that they merit a discussion. So, to my first component. The embedding phase, although necessary for the creation of the edifice of human rights forming the basis of the convention system, has been, some have argued, an inherently top-down juridical project where an international court has been at the vanguard of formulating and giving life to legal norms which may have impacted the day-to-day lives of democratic societies all over Europe. In other words, the argument seems to suggest that a crisis of legalism may have occurred, as it was termed by Professor Gunnar Geertie in his 2005 Hamelin lectures, Can Human Rights Survive? Convention rights have thus, the argument proceeds further, been developed through language formulated by international jurists and judges like myself, over and above national democratic political life, as constituting pre-political or supra-political legal norms in the sense of being created in isolation from the political community to which they belong. As Professor Geertie puts it, human rights have thus somehow falsely become detached from politics. To put it differently, although the Strasbourg Court has in general been very successful in its embedding process at the level of providing justice on a case-by-case basis in many areas of contemporary political and social life, as well as being at the origins of the many meaningful structural and institutional reforms, which is an achievement we should never underestimate, the convention system, under this argument, has perhaps not managed to infuse convention values into the domestic political psyche at the democratic level, akin to already embedded constitutional principles. Now, of course, this argument applies differently in different member states. But for present purposes, as a component in the characterization of the court's perceived legitimacy problem, it is my hope that I am justified to set it forth in abstract terms. My second component in addressing the question why it is argued that the court has a legitimacy problem is related to the first, but is rather directed at the way some of the court's overarching methodological principles have been perceived by relevant stakeholders in the member states. For example, who hasn't heard a politician publicly lambasting the court's use of the living instrument doctrine, or lamenting the fact that the court has second-guessed or substituted its judgment on whether a restriction on a particular right is necessary on the facts? Article 8, family and privacy rights, are particularly topical here, and the rights of foreign nationals and immigrants under Article 3 which prohibits ill treatment, as well as fair trial rights under Article 6 of the of persons charged with or convicted of a crime. In sum, the perceived diminished legitimacy of the court that can be traced to these elements is, on this argument, firstly grounded in the doctrine of original expectations of the member states, i.e. that the court's interpretations have lost their rational connection to the expected original meaning held by the ratifying states. In other words, perceived as a sovereignty or a separation of powers problem. Secondly, this component manifests itself in the rejection of the idea that whilst it is accepted that the Strasbourg Court has an important role in giving life to the rights protected by the convention, it is not its role to apply strict scrutiny to the domestic assessment of necessity for their restriction. In other words, it is claimed at this stage that at the stage of balancing individual rights and the public interest and of using the principle of proportionality, the juridical or legal part of the assessment is in the strict sense over, and political and policy factors come into play where the Strasbourg Court is not in a better or more knowledgeable position than the domestic decision maker. But these are the two components, theorized components of the court's perceived legitimacy problem. Okay. Now, having now briefly explained these two components, let me proceed by arguing that the court's historical, and one may justifiably call, seismic shift from the embedding phase towards the current period, which I will call the procedural enforcement phase, is both empirically correct and normatively justified, and that this shift can potentially be beneficial for the court's sustained legitimacy and effectiveness, in particular, its effectiveness at national level when looking to the future. In an article I published in 2014, I questioned whether the Strasbourg Court might be entering what I termed an age of subsidiarity. I can assure you I have never said anything publicly that has provoked as much scholarly debate. I admit it was a broad brush claim and meant to provoke discussion, but I presented certain arguments in favor of a positive answer. Today, 3 years later, I will go a step further and assert, albeit cautiously, that there are clear signs in the case law that the court is engaged in the process of more robustly applying the principle of subsidiarity. It would, of course, take far too long to make the empirical arguments in full, as I would have to analyze an abundance of case law. But interesting recent work has been done by prominent academics that purport to demonstrate the increased use of subsidiarity and margin of appreciation type reasoning in case law. A recent article published by Professor Mikhail Rasmussen, the director of the famous iCourts Research Institute at the University of Copenhagen, presents the claims, the first ever systematic examination of the case law following the Brighton Declaration using databanks of cases. These databanks of cases, he says, focus on the use of the margin of appreciation and subsidiarity. He finds that when the statistical analyses are read together, the overall conclusion suggests that the Strasbourg Court is, and I quote, indeed providing more subsidiarity following the Brighton Declaration. He further notes that although this is not a general phenomenon which cuts across all convention provisions, nevertheless, and I quote, in all cases, the usages of the doctrine are either continued at a high level or further increased following the Brighton Declaration. So at a minimum, there seems to be some empirical grounding for the conclusion that the descriptive or empirical claim has merit, although the complex case law of an international court like the Strasbourg Court can never maintain a fully linear trajectory. There are, of course, exceptions in recent case law which undermine the subsidiarity-based thesis. Be that as it may, the more interesting and difficult question is the normative one. Namely, is this development justified and to be lauded? It is to this question that I now turn. To begin with, the normative debate on whether the Strasbourg Court should apply a more robust principle of subsidiarity, in other words, a more process-based review of domestic decision-making, is on the one hand an institutional debate, where views certainly differ on whether the court should, to use the simplistic but often used terms, be activist or restrained. It is, on the other hand, a debate that goes to the source of the norms, which are the subject matter of the debate, that is, the nature and scope of human rights. Before describing the three main institutional elements that give expression to the procedural enforcement phase, allow me first to reflect on the way in which one's view of the concept of human rights has crucial implications for where, on the axis of the activism and restraint spectrum, one situates oneself. It is often argued by those that feel alarmed at the subsidiarity-based trend in the court's case law that it undermines the so-called universality of human rights, by which a unitary concept of human rights is deployed, giving the impression that human rights is one concept, one norm, legal or moral. As I do not want to enter too deeply into the rich debate on the philosophical foundations of human rights, which I will do in a written paper on this issue, I will limit myself to arguing that at a minimum, this conceptual criticism is not persuasive within the context of the European Convention on Human Rights. The reason for this is simple. The convention does not protect any unitary, sole, or standalone human right. On the contrary, it protects an array of rights that are firstly not necessarily interrelated or can easily be justified by the same moral or political conception of human rights. Secondly, and crucially, as I will explain in a moment, some rights under the convention are couched in absolute terms, like Article 3 on ill treatment, Article 4 on slavery and forced labor, and Article 7 on the principle of legality in criminal cases. Others, and often the more contentious ones, like Article 8 on the right to privacy, are quite fundamental, but they're also often contested as to their scope and application because they explicitly or implicitly allow for restrictions. As I previously intimated, the distinction between absolute and qualified rights is crucial when identifying ways in which the court should proceed in the future. Absolute convention rights protect values and interests which emanate from the core of the human person and his or her dignity, and are therefore, by definition, at least in their negative aspects, not amenable to any kind of balancing or proportionality type analysis, which opens the door for democratic, political, and policy choices. Absolute rights are therefore rooted in a moral conception of human rights. They are, in other words, moral imperatives. It is the primordial role of the Strasbourg Court, as I see it, to enforce the collective guarantee of the protection of absolute rights. So my thesis here today on the increased role of subsidiarity and process-based review within the convention system must by definition be limited, I say in general terms, not completely, to qualified rights under the convention. Although one cannot, of course, exclude process-based arguments from entering into the equation when dealing with cases implicating the state's positive obligations under the absolute provisions. A further reason for the importance of this distinction is that the permitted limitations of certain convention rights, in particular under Articles 8 to 11, are based on their restrictions being necessary in a democratic society. In other words, the convention explicitly and textually infuses political and policy-based consideration into the overall assessment of the existence of qualified rights in a particular case. One may thus argue that qualified rights have primarily legal and philosophical foundations of a political nature, as they are not mere expressions of the political status and responsibilities of individuals, but, and this is important, of their status and responsibilities within a democratic and communal entity, not their status as islands unto themselves. Therefore, these rights are not rooted to the same extent in a moral theory on the dignity of the human person as are absolute rights, but find their mooring, perhaps to a larger extent, in political conceptions of human rights. This distinction, which in no way is not debatable, is, I hope, clear. because it has in, they have, this distinction has institutional implications for the future trajectory of the court in the light of the perceived legitimacy problem and its two-dimensional components that I explained a moment ago. I have made the claim this evening that the Strasbourg system's historical phase of embedding principles of convention law into national legal system has, as such, come to an end, and the age of subsidiarity is now underway, where the focus is on the procedural enforcement of the embedded principle. To explain in more detail what the procedural enforcement phase entails and how it should affect the future trajectory of the court, it is at the outset important to recall the two components I identified a moment ago that some consider as forming the basis of the Strasbourg court's legitimacy problem. If one views the core of these components of criticism, one may perhaps see it as, see it finding its expression to some extent in the lack of domestic empowerment of the convention system. The rights holders, the individuals and legal persons, look primarily to Strasbourg for justice, hence the 90,000 pending cases. Many national judges and practitioners view the convention system as an international ensemble of norms, not homegrown, not a part of their own constitutional, political, or social fabric. They are thus hesitant when called upon to develop independently convention rights. Some politicians feel as if their democratic mandates are being threatened by, as some have said, unelected international judges imposing their will on the peoples of Europe. I am elected by them. In other words, some members of the political establishment consider that important elements of social and economic policy are being determined outside of the national democratic or judicial processes. Now, one can, of course, take the view that the criticism of the convention system is a natural consequence of an international system for the collective enforcement of human rights, and that the court and the convention system should not be bothered by such criticism. It's not the right approach to take, in my view. Every international system of law has a system that, by definition, is not embedded politically and historically in a national constitutional framework, is from time to time confronted with the threat of losing its effectiveness at national level if a critical mass of distrust and a perceived lack of legitimacy pervades its work. The historical trajectory of the convention system has, by its very nature and current status, thus called for a shift of focus to secure the increased effectiveness of human rights protections at national level, by moving from the embedding of convention principles towards a bottom-up strategy, empowering national rights holders and decision makers to take the lead in enforcing and guaranteeing human rights. On this basis, allow me now, before I conclude with some final reflections, to describe the three main elements of the procedural enforcement phase moving forward into the future. In other words, elaborate on the means, one might argue, that the Strasbourg Court is currently deploying to effectuate an approach that allows for increased domestic empowerment of convention rights. Firstly, as previously mentioned, at the technical level, the court has developed its exhaustion of domestic remedies jurisprudence under Article 35 of the convention in recent years, in particular with its Grand Chamber judgment in Vukovic and others versus Serbia of March 2013, which did indeed confirm already settled principles, but may be interpreted, and I believe many of us interpret it in this way, as requiring applicants to be more diligent in raising their convention complaints than transpired from previous case law for remedies to be properly exhausted. The consequences for the UK context can be gleaned primarily from two inadmissibility decisions from early last year in the cases of Roberts versus the United Kingdom and Peacock versus the United Kingdom. As things stand, applicants have effectively to demonstrate that they have not only pleaded the convention issue domestically, at least in substance, but done so in a manner that has realistically given the national judge the opportunity to consider the issue through a convention lens. The purpose of this more restrictive and stringent standard for the exhaustion of domestic remedies is clear. It is the national forum which is the primary arena for resolving convention disputes, not Strasbourg. It is thus for the potential rights holder to take control of his or her convention-based destiny, if you will, and for the national judge to apply the embedded principle which he or she will readily find in approximately 95% of cases by consulting the relevant materials, as I previously argued. The second element of the procedural enforcement phase manifests itself in important case law, in particular grand chamber judgments, increasingly being formulated in terms of providing, in the general principles part, objective interpretational criteria that can guide national decision makers in their application of the convention at ground level. Many examples, recent examples can be given. For example, Ibrahim and others versus the UK providing criteria for the assessment of fairness in criminal cases under Article 6. Roman Zakharov versus Russia providing criteria for the assessment of domestic systems of targeted surveillance under Article 8. Von Hanover versus Germany, number 2, on the balancing between Article 8 and 10 in defamation cases, and Uner versus the Netherlands and Maslow versus Austria as regards the expulsion of convicted foreign nationals. As to the latter, I note that in the UK context, a very recent judgment of Ndidi versus the UK, delivered late last month, constitutes, in my view, the apex of the court's subsidiarity-based jurisprudence in the field of expulsion of foreign criminals. In that case, the court, for the first time in a case under Article 8 alone, and dealing with the family life rights of foreign-born convicted nationals, imported the von Hanover non-substitution principle from the Article 8-10 context, thus transposing the court's finding that strong reasons are needed to substitute its judgment for that of the national courts, where the balancing of interest has taken place at the national level. Lastly, allow me to mention here the Grand Chamber judgment in Barbulescu versus Romania, also delivered just last month, dealing with the issue of an employer's monitoring of employees' email usage in the workplace, in which the Grand Chamber, in meticulous detail, provides no less than 6 criteria that national decision makers should look to under Article 8 when assessing the proportionality of such measures. The purpose of this second and crucial element in the court's process-based review mechanism is domestically to empower and incentivize national judges to engage forcefully with embedded principles when having to undertake the often complicated assessment of legality, legitimate aim, and necessity under the limitation clauses of qualified convention provisions. If done faithfully at the national level, the Strasbourg judge will, as a departing point of principle, accept the result as being within the realm of reasonable outcomes, adopted by the national decision maker more directly attuned and sensitive to the necessities of the domestic and democratic legal order. The third element of the court's procedural enforcement phase is its refusal to draw any distinction of principle between the subsidiarity-based deference that may be afforded to national authorities of a judicial or executive nature on the one hand, or on the other, the domestic parliaments producing legislative norms that are facially challenged before the Strasbourg Court. Examples of the latter are cases like Animal Defenders International versus the UK, SAS versus France, the case concerning the ban on full-face veils, as recently confirmed in the corresponding Belgian cases, Dakir versus Belgium, and Belchatsemi and Husser versus Belgium. In other words, the court will look closely at whether the national parliament, in enacting primary legislation which adversely affects convention rights, has openly and in good faith engaged with the balancing of conflicting interests. Just to be clear, a closer examination of this third parliamentary element of process-based review would merit a separate lecture or indeed a separate conference, if you will. If you want to read about this, Professors Donald and Leach have written a book on the issue, which you should definitely buy immediately. Before concluding, and now I'm going to have a sip of water, it is time to alleviate the concerns of those that may interpret what I have said as a judicial manifesto for a weaker, more government-friendly convention system. In other words, a lowering of standards for human rights protections across Europe. That is not the case. Quite on the contrary. An effective procedural enforcement phase should actually increase the general level of convention protections, not lower. Why? Because subsidiarity-based deference is premised on actual and good faith domestic engagement with convention principles. In other words, The court may grant deference if national decision makers actually apply the general principles and are structurally capable of fulfilling that task. This also means, importantly, that the foundations of the domestic legal order have to be intact. States that do not respect the rule of law, do not ensure the impartiality and independence of their judicial systems, oppress political opponents, or mask prejudice and hostilities towards vulnerable groups or minorities, cannot expect to be afforded deference under process-based review. Furthermore, the court's increased emphasis on the principle of subsidiarity in no way gives a carte blanche to member states in their choice of measures and means that restrict convention rights, even though a balancing of interests has taken place at the domestic level. History has amply demonstrated that there is an inherent risk in democratic societies that majoritarian sentiments, subsequently translated into legislative enactments and practice, are formed on the basis of ideas and values which threaten fundamental human rights. Insular and vulnerable groups are therefore left with recourse to courts. And these courts, whether national or international, like the Strasbourg Court, have the duty to review and detect, if possible, whether the imposition of measures, although widely accepted, are triggered by animus or intolerance towards a particular idea, view, or religious faith. You may finally be questioning whether the future process-based review in Strasbourg will inevitably lead to double standards of human rights protections within the Council of Europe. It, of course, depends on what you mean by double standards. My understanding of this assertion leads me to answer in the negative. The Convention's general principles apply equally in all member states, and the Court's process-based supervision of their domestic enforcement is, at the level of principle, the same for each state. But it is a fact of life that states have not progressed or are not progressing in the same manner when it comes to the embedded status of Convention law. That is not the fault of the Strasbourg system, but the unfortunate result or consequence of certain domestic, political, historical, and social developments. So allow me in conclusion to sum up. There are clear signs that the historical trajectory of the Strasbourg system from the embedding phase to the current procedural enforcement phase is an empirical reality, but more importantly, a development that is normatively justified on both institutional and substantive grounds. It will, in my view, sustain and support in the long run the system's overall legitimacy for the peoples of Europe, and hopefully at the same time result in the progressive decrease in the number of applications at Strasbourg. This will also lead to a commensurate increase in the level of convention protections at national level, at least in those member states that take their convention obligations seriously and apply the general principles set out by the European Court of Human Rights in good faith. Thank you very much.
Post-Bryson in 2012 and perhaps even more so post-Brussels conference in 2015, and the focus on the importance of national domestic implementation of rights. We've got a few minutes before, I don't want to keep you from the refreshments for too long, but we have some time for questions. If you would like to introduce yourself briefly, and if you could limit your contribution to a question rather than any kind of lengthy statement so we can get more questions in. We do have a microphone. Yes, if you could say who you are and then put your question.
I think you have your hand up as well. Oh, no,
Hi, my name is Gerhard. I'm a DFL from Oxford. My question is in relation to the mechanism that we currently have that enables the execution of the court's judgments. I was wondering whether you see any weaknesses in terms of this mechanism, because ultimately the mechanism will have an impact on the legitimacy of the court and its ability to do what you're saying, to work towards a process-based review.
Thank you. Shall I just take one more question and we can do a couple at a time?
Thank you, sir. My name is Konstantin Dikhtyarov. I work at the University of Liverpool. And if I may, two very quick questions. My first question is, what do you think if the court can be accused of hiding behind process-based review, kind of omitting substantive decisions for process-based review, changing its reasoning from real, going into real reasons for a particular judgment and saying, okay, that is what we think is was wrong from the process base, therefore we are not even going into the real substantive reasons. And my second question is about the effectiveness of the strategy that you very nicely explained. How effective would be process-based review in enhancing the legitimacy, the perceived legitimacy of the European Court of Human Rights? In those examples that you have given in SAS, for example, the court found no violation due to process-based review. But what if the court finds violation on the same in the same situation? I'm thinking about cases like Hirsch number 2 and obviously prisoner voting debate saga. In Hirsch number 2, the court also referred to process, saying that the parliament has never debated this issue, but it didn't really help the court in enhancing the legitimacy of that particular case. So I can give you another example of the case of Alexeyev in Russia, where the court was talking about the prohibition of equality parade in Moscow, and there the court also referred to process-based arguments, and it also was very perceived very negatively in the Russian Federation. My question is how process-based review can enhance the legitimacy of the European Court of Human Rights when in the majority of cases the popular opinion about the court is about the results rather than the reasoning. Thank you very much.
Quite a lot to
do
with there, so perhaps that's enough for now.
Yeah. as to the question from the colleague from Oxford, as most of you probably know, at least some of you know, the execution system of the convention is a political system. It's a system of political pressure. It is performed by the Committee of Ministers, which is an ensemble of the foreign ministers of the Council of Europe States. And from the perspective of a judge sitting at Strasbourg in the court itself, I have to be very careful when I talk about the execution system. By the definition of it being a political system based on dialogue between political entities, there are weaknesses there. It's clear the Strasbourg court is not like a UK Supreme Court or a court in a member state where judgments are binding at the point of delivery. That is a system which we are seeing now needs perhaps to rethink to some extent the ways in which it goes about. And I know the execution department within the Council of Europe is strategizing about ways and means of trying to simplify some kinds of resolutions by the Committee of Ministers. And then you also have the court, and this is what we'll be talking about next month, this month, in Strasbourg, the issue of remedial measures by the court, where the court is trying to assist, is trying to provide tools for the effective execution of our judgments. But that is a very sensitive issue, for the simple reason that the logic of the Article 46 of the Convention is clear. There is a clear separation between the judicial function, the actual declaratory judgment given, stating the findings in a particular case with an operative provision, and the subsequent execution. And the fluctuating paradigm between the two is very difficult. And there, I can tell you, in my court, there are differing views on the legal basis upon which the court can proceed any further than we have already done, which we have in many cases gone very far in providing for individual measures for execution. As to the question from the colleague from Liverpool, well, I think the accusation that the court using deference type reasoning is always going to be there from those that don't like the result. That is just, that's just a fact of life. You cannot, SAS versus France is a very good example because it is a, the actual outcome of the case, the actual result for the applicant and similarly situated applicant is something that I think most peoples, most lay persons in Europe can have a view on. SAS versus France, I think most of you know, it's the case on the full face veils of Muslim women. What the point of process-based review is the differences in the lines of reasoning you will see in cases of that type. The accusation is often made that process-based review and that type of starting point is necessarily going to translate into more no-violation judgments. That does not necessarily follow. For example, and I'm not going to name any states now, because that would be very difficult to me. Using this type of approach in states which, let's put it this way, are underdeveloped when it comes to national judges applying convention principles, will not lead to more no-violation judgments. Because if the national judge simply has not, you know, there is no semblance of the national judge through his reasoning having engaged with convention principles, there is simply no deference. So if you think about it in those terms, and I think I can take another example of a court which is definitely at the other limits of that, on the other, the UK Supreme Court, which I think is in some ways even better than ourselves in analyzing convention law. How do you see that translate into our judgments? It simply means the legwork has been done, and the question of whether the outcome is a reasonable one is open to question. There will come cases along, and I think SAS is one of them, where the court adopts a very aggressive process-based review, but the question is, and I'm now on record, I mean, I wrote a concurring opinion in the Belgian burqa cases. If anybody reads those, my concurring opinion will know that I have problems with SAS. So even a process-based review mechanism has limits, goes without saying. This is a framework of principles. It is not, it doesn't dictate, it can never dictate the end result in all cases. We will have principles, we will have issues come up in the foreseeable future. Issues of bioethics, issues dealing with right to life issues, where the court has perhaps said little or nothing. Don't expect the court to come there with a pure process-based review mechanism, because the embedding principle is perhaps not even there. So one has to look at process-based review as a framework in which we work. Instead of me looking at the human rights dispute head on and not looking at all what has happened before, in other words, I come afresh to the issue, I ask myself first, no, what has the national decision maker done? And I will analyze the issue through that lens. It is a completely different way of looking at things. If you look at judgments of the European Court of Human Rights, for example, in immigration cases under Article 8, from the beginning of the millennia, 2000 to 2005, just simply the way the court reasons to a conclusion is, I would venture to guess and venture to claim, different from what it is today. For example, in the merits reasoning, you would see literal nothing about what the domestic court actually said. Simply that doctrinal step from reasoning on the basis upon the domestic assessment is, I think, a way in which legitimacy can be enhanced, at least at the professional level, domestically. And we know that when something translates into the professional psyche, that may have an impact on the way these issues are perceived in political circles. There is your second point dealing with some of these cases. How does it enhance legitimacy? The argument, the argument is in my, it's not a very complex argument if one thinks about it. We are in a situation, even in my country, I come from Iceland, which is a Nordic country, which I think on balance is a human rights oriented country. How can it be that my Supreme Court and judges on my Supreme Court, they simply view the convention as something that is there. It's not ours. It is something that I'm supposed to look to, but I do it with hesitations. How can that be the case after almost 7 years? Why has that been the case? How can we change that way of thinking? It's happening now through legal studies and the way we are teaching the law. And I think there is a generational shift that will happen. But I think that is itself problematic, that the convention has not sort of been infused into the legal argumentation as sort of a norm at domestic level. And how can the Strasbourg court incentivize that? It must be by trying to find ways in which the issue itself, if dealt with domestically in the appropriate way, has benefits for the domestic system. And it's either or. It's either or in this regard.
Thank you. Time for a couple more questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My name's Brian. I'm a company director. So what are the measures of success for this strategy? How will those success factors be measured, and who will measure them?
The first.
Oh, sorry, just.
Yeah, sorry.
Shall we? Yeah.
I'm Mary Zane Watson from Queen Mary, University of London. And I was just concerned that if the National Court has also adopted a process of review, and then the European Court adopts a process-based review, when will the real question of human rights ever be considered? Is there any scope for new developments in convention jurisprudence?
As to the first question, the first concept that you used is success. What do you mean by success? You don't have to answer it, because I don't think you know the answer yourself, because I don't, definitely. Whether something like this is successful is impossible to answer in any terms. The convention system will never be uncritical or unfazed by criticism. It goes without saying, the nature of the system is such that it will always be debated. It needs to be debated. What the problematic aspect of the situation as it stands, in my view, is that it seems to suggest that human rights protections, an international enforcement system of human rights, is somehow undemocratic. I would venture to guess, if the Strasbourg Court is still in existence in 20, 30 years, which I hope it will be, I'm pretty sure it will be, that if there is a measure of success, it will be that the court has been able to go through a period of transformation in a manner which has allowed for an acceptance, also with a generational shift within the legal community at domestic level, within the political communities at domestic level, which provides acceptance that the system itself has benefits, which are pure cost-benefit analysis, is reaping awards which would not be there if the system wasn't in place. So in other words, we wouldn't have what we are having now, which is an existential type debate, a black and white debate, withdraw the convention or not. But we still have a debate on individual outcomes. That is fine. For me as a human rights judge, it would be abnormal if the Strasbourg court would render judgments which everybody would always be happy about, then I wouldn't be doing my job. The nature of the system is such that it will create, it moves from a certain status quo into something new. If we can do that without an existential crisis, but rather a debate at the individual level, I would say that is success. The second, now here I think that there's a bit of a misunderstanding. Process-based review is review performed by an international court. Process-based review is not review performed by a national court.
No, but I mean if the national court has already adopted a similar approach, they've not really looked at the substance. They've looked at the decision-making process and decided that it's a good decision-making
process. So in other words, a domestic court hasn't assessed proportionality?
Well, they've afforded a lot of deference to the national decision-making bodies, so it's the legislature or perhaps the executive.
Yes, I mean...
And then you get more deference at the level of European
yes.
court, and so... I'm thinking of the example of the Nicholson case,
yep.
which was found to be inadmissible. And lots of people in the UK felt that that was never properly considered by the national.
I think a better case is the recent tragic case of Charlie Gard versus in the UK Supreme Court, which is a case about the UK courts giving a lot of deference to the medical establishment and things of that sort. My answer is simple. It all depends on the convention right in question. It depends on the general principles that have been adopted by the court and the required judicial scrutiny under our case law for the domestic decision maker. In the case you mentioned, the case law doesn't afford, I mean, the case law when it comes to, I'll call it a Nicholson type situation, our case law, the case law of my court, simply doesn't require the national judge to be very forceful. There is a lot of deference in those types of situations. Let's take another example. We talked about absolute provisions. I mean, if we don't see in the case law, let me take a better example, Article 6 criminal fairness cases. If you don't see national judges' engagement with issues of procedural faults and assessment of illegally obtained evidence, if they simply say, well, we're not going to look into it, then we will not afford any deference in the overall criminal fairness assessment. Issues of children's rights, best interest type analysis, if that is not performed domestically, then process-based review, the parameters of process-based review are not fulfilled. There can be cases, of course, where the question will arise, to what extent, I mean, I think socioeconomic rights, for example, rights under Article 1 or Protocol 1, which are qualified rights, where you will see a domestic court, for example, when we're talking about issues of taxation or things of that sort, where automatically a national court will grant a lot of deference. But that's the same, but there's nothing more required under the convention. So it's a situation where there is a clash between the requirements under the principles in the court's case law to the domestic. I think the issue of, I mentioned now on monitoring, Barbulescu versus Romania, the question of whether an employer can monitor employee usage, there we will require, under the Grand Chamber judgment I just mentioned, certain elements to be tested at domestic level. And if they're not tested, well then, this approach will not afford benefits at national level.
Great, thank you. I think at this stage I probably shouldn't keep you any further from refreshments. So Robert mentioned and I mentioned at the beginning that we have another event in Strasbourg. This is on the 8th of November, a seminar on the court's developing approach to remedies, which intersects in a very interesting way with this debate we've just had this evening. Terms of how, if you like, how intrusive the Strasbourg system is at the domestic level. I will make sure that everybody who's registered for this event gets a notice of that event, should any of you be in Strasbourg or in
just a simple train ride, no problem.
The incentive being you'll be able to hear Robert speaking again alongside other people, also from the committee minister's side on this issue. But after that plug, it just reminds me to thank again Judge Spano for coming to speak to us tonight. There are refreshments outside, and I'm sure you wouldn't mind if people can approach you to pursue more lines of questioning over a glass of wine and something to eat. So thank you very much again.
Thank you very much.
Listen, you can have my key card here.